My name is Sushma Joshi. I am a writer and filmmaker from Kathmandu, Nepal. My dilemma is, in the absence of a functioning state and its inability to bring drinking water to its citizens, should a city like Kathmandu bring back its traditional age-old methods of water conservation?
My name is Siso Kingondu. I work for Nelson Mandela African Institute of Science and Technology, that is in Tanzania. And my dilemma today is, should Tanzania, in our effort to industrialize, choose coal and gas over environmental protection, or choose environmental protection over industrialization?
How can international policy shift away from the idea of big reservoirs of water from faraway places being brought in by polythene pipes and towards the notion of local conservation of water? How can we bring back the idea that green spaces are necessary in cities like Kathmandu and that asphalt has to be contained so that water can seep into the ground and recharge it? There has to be a total environmental change in the way people look at city planning in order to provide water to large populations of people without first world utility services.
Tanzania is endowed with a mix of energy resources, including gas, coal, solar, wind, hydropower, and geothermal. However, it faces serious energy crisis characterized by constant power fluctuation, rationing, and outages. With the huge number of people in the rural Tanzania, that is about 80% of the total population, lacking access to national grid, and the economy that has been growing steadily at 6% annually for 10 years, there is a growing push in exploiting Tanzania's coal and gas reserves, as well as wind and solar resources.
People come here, I think initially, probably looking for answers. And we try fairly quickly to tell them that's not why we're here. We're here to think about the kinds of issues you're facing. And maybe part of it is realizing that every context is unique. So people from outside that context aren't going to be able to provide a solution that fits necessarily. What they can do is provide some ideas about ways to work through the issues that you're dealing with.
Well, the group was very useful in coming up with practical solutions to this problem. And what they suggested to me is, because I'm a filmmaker, they suggested I should work on an advocacy film, which would bring attention of all different segments of society to this issue and also to show them what still remains. So I think that's a very useful tool. And then they suggested getting the attention of UNESCO and trying to register just the water systems in the valley, not the architectural heritage, not the other cultural heritage, but just the water systems into the UNESCO World Heritage Site system. And then they also recommended bringing together a lobby of concerned citizens, conservators, historical conservation people, water scientists, the municipality, the city, and bringing them all together at the same table and discussing a way to bring forward a policy that might be able to revive these systems.
I found it very fruitful. And there are things that I started appreciating. Before that, before the discussion, I was not looking at the solution like it can be a mix of two or three things. It was either coal or environmental protection, or it's either conventional fuels or the renewables. But from our discussion, I started appreciating, or I realized that I can look at it from a different dimension.
People left with a reconceptualization, or they left with a reframing, or they left saying, no, I was asking good questions, but the wrong questions. Let me ask a different set of questions. Or they left with a set of new ingredients, new dimensions that needed to be included. So for many, they hadn't thought, for example, about the element of design. and the aesthetics of design. Design is also about beauty. It's not just about functionality or technical robustness or energy efficiency. So now we have participants who've said they're going to go back and they're going to think about aesthetics. Or engineers who had never thought about history and the social history. So they're working in a rural area, they're working on an engineering problem, but they hadn't thought about the history of land use in that area. So now they'll go back and think about that. So we think that we were successful by dilemmas in getting the rethink, getting the reframe, the reconceptualization, also in some cases a menu of possible technical solutions. We were able to do both by framing the problem as dilemma and asking people to come and share that.